हेलो श्रीदिना, वी आर लाइव नाउ, वी कैन स्टार्ट।
थैंक यू मनीष। नमस्ते एंड गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल। दिस इज सुदीना श्रेष्ठ एंड आई विल बी मॉडरेटिंग द सेशन टुडे। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ आवर ऑप्टम टीम, आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम ऑल द ऑडियंस कनेक्टेड टू अस थ्रू दिस ई लर्निंग सेशन। स्टार्टिंग द सेशन विद अ ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ आवर प्रोग्राम। फॉर ऑप्टम स्टूडेंट प्रेजेंटेशन इज इनिशिएटेड बाई फॉर ऑप्टम टीम, वेर स्टूडेंट्स प्रेजेंट ऑन वेरियस ऑप्टोमेट्री रिलेटेड टॉपिक्स। टूडे वी हैव मिस पूजाश्री पी विथ अस। Ms. Pujashree is currently studying second year BSc Optometry in Netradhama School of Optometry, Bangalore. Today, she will be discussing on slit lamp biomicroscopy. As the session is live on YouTube, I request you all to drop any queries if you have during the presentation in the chat box. We will be discussing all the queries at the end of the session. Pujashree, you can take over the session now.
Thank you, Sudina, and thank you for Optum. All the dignitaries, viewers present here, good evening one and all. Myself, Pooja. And I'm going to present on the topic about slit lamp biomicroscopy. What is, first of all, slit lamp? And slit lamp is an ophthalmic instrument which is used to focus through a narrow slit to illumination the patient eye being weaved under the eyepiece. It is generally used by the ophthalmologist and optometrist to look at the magnified in order for them to diagnose any possible eye disease or refractive errors. So biomicroscope derives its names because it enables us to look at the living tissue of the eye under the magnification, and it also provides a three-dimensional view and a stereoscopic view of the patient eye through a binocular eyepiece. This slit lamp, it does not only provide the magnified view, it also provides a photography of every part of documentation and also it allows the quantitative measurements. Coming into the history, Perkinje in 1823 attempted to develop a type of slit lamp by using one handheld lamp. What is this one handheld lamp? Okay, it is also called as handheld slit lamp. It is a portable slit lamp which can be carried anywhere, and it is also used to examine the patient in supine position. Means the patient will be lying horizontally, the back, he will be lying at the back and the face towards the forward. And it is very light in case, and it also provides a wider interpupillary dioptric range and the field of view. So the Perkinje used this one hand held lamp in one to magnify, and in the other hand he used lens to focus the strong oblique illumination. Whereas in 1863, the D. Vector, he devised a portable ophthalmomicroscope which consists of a small monocular eyepiece microscope. In 1891, Albert and Greenough, they developed a binocular microscope which provided a stereoscopic view. The stereoscopic view is nothing but the image. We can see the depth of the image. Gulstrand in 1911 introduced the illumination system which had for the first time a slit diaphragm in it. So we should thank to Dr. Albert Gulstrand who introduced the concept of slit lamp in 1911. Next, in 1933, Hans Goldmann improvised the biomicroscope in which we can adjust both the lamp and slit beam in any adjustment, like it may be a vertical or horizontal, which where the lamp and the slit beam will be placed on a single mechanical stage. Later in 1950, Littmann introduced an optical principle for the biomicroscope. Actually, he said he incorporated two systems of slit lamp, that is, one is illumination and observation system. He incorporated two on a movable trolley about a common center and a vertical axis. Here, the foci also will be on the same plane, and these two systems coupled around the same center of rotation to ensure power focus of the microscope and slit lamp. So in layman language, we can just define it as coplanar, coaxial, and copivotal. Coming to the principle of slit lamp refers like a very bright light from the lamp produced by the lamp. With this beam of light, we can just focus in the eye and we can weave the eye under magnification with some control of illumination. Whereas come to optics, it works on the same principle as a compound microscope. So what is the principle of compound microscope? Is nothing but a beam of visible light is focused by the condenser lens onto the patient's eye. Here, the objective lens will pick up the light from the transmitted by the patient, and this created a magnified image of the patient. This principle is also used same as in the slit lamp biomicroscope. Next, here we have objective lens, which is towards the patient, and we have the eyepiece, which is towards the examiner. So the objective lens is just consists of two plano convex lens with their curvature put together. They have a composite power of plus 22 diopter. Here the eyepiece will be having diopter power of plus 10 to plus 14 diopter. Here, what is condenser lens is nothing but it just provides a divergent beam from a point source into a parallel converging beam to illuminate an object. Next, coming to types, there are two types. One is this slit lamp biomicroscope, and is another one is Hagstreet slit lamp biomicroscope. How can you differentiate both of them? So there is a difference in the location of the illumination system. As you see here in Zeiss, you can see the illumination system is at the base of the slit lamp, whereas in the Hagstreet, you can here observe it is at the top of the slit lamp. Next, coming to instrumentation, this instrumentation is further classified into three systems. We can even divide it into three systems, that is mechanical system, observation system, and illumination system. First, we'll have a look over the mechanical system. This mechanical system basically consists of a motorized stable power switch. It has a table height adjustment control, a joystick to manual the illumination and microscope together. And we have a patient positioning frame. It consists of four headband, a fixation target, canthus alignment marker, chin rest, and chin rest adjustment knob. Here, as you can see in the picture, you can see here the fixation target. Here you can see the fixation target. It is just a diopter adjustment and it helps the patient to see the target clearly. And here you can see the chin rest adjustment knob, which is used to adjust the patient's chin rest according to the patient's chin rest and comfort. Here the joystick which you are seeing, it is used for focusing. It can be moved forward, backward, laterally or diagonally. And the joystick can also be rotated to lower or elevate the light beam. Here you can see the power switch, and here you can see the table height adjustment. Next, coming to forehead band, and then canthus alignment, chin rest, where the patient's chin is rested. Here is the lock for the slit lamp base. What is the use of this is nothing but if whenever the slit lamp is not in use, we can just lock it so there will be no movement of the slit lamp. Here you have low friction plate. It is used in such a way that we can move the joystick very easily without any discomfort. Coming to the observation system. So in observation system, it essentially consists of eyepiece with binocular compound microscope. It has prism housing, knob to change the magnification and the objective lens. Here you can see in the picture, eyepiece. Here it is the binocular eyepiece. It just provides a stereoscopic vision and it can be adjusted to accommodate the examiner's interpupillary distance. So the examiner can adjust according to his interpupillary distance. And here you can see there is a marked ring. It is used to adjust the examiner's refractive error. If at all the examiner having refractive error and he may not feel comfortable with the spectacle lenses, he can just remove it and he can adjust his refractive error here. And you can here even see a prism housing, and this is a knob to change magnification, and here you can see an objective lens. Coming to the illumination system, it consists of light source with the condenser lens system. And you have a scale for a slit height control. Slit height control knob is also present. And you have a filter control, reflecting prism, slit with control knob, centering screw, and a latch to tilt the light column. I'll be showing this and all in the picture. You can see here, scale for slit height. Here it is the scale for slit height. And you have a knob which you can use it to change the slit height. And you have here an inclined mirror. It is just used to reform an image. Here you can see a latch to tilt the light column. It is used to tilt moving the illumination arm in 80 degrees at any side so that examiner may move it according so that he can direct the light of beam of light anywhere between the nasal and temporal aspect of eye examination. It is just moved based on his pivoting basis. And when it is coming to the light source, here you can see it is present at the top. Next is the filter control. And then is a centering screw. Why the centering screw is used? It is used because when it is tightened, the image doesn't move where we are focusing. First, suppose if it is loosened, if at all it is loosened, then the slit can be moved away from the center of the field of observation. So after centering the image, it should be tightened. Then you can see the slit with control here. Next, coming to the magnification, magnification is further classified into three types: low magnification, medium magnification, and high magnification. Low magnification, under low magnification, you can just observe a general eye. It is from 7x to 10x. Under medium magnification, you can just see the structure of individual layers like cornea layers and etc. Medium magnification is 20x to 25x. Next, you can see under high magnification, you can see a detailed structure. It is from 30x to 40x. Let us look at this under low magnification, what and all we can see. Under low magnification, we can observe lids, bulbar conjunctiva, sclera, cornea, limbus, anterior chamber, iris, and crystalline lids. Whereas in medium magnification, you can observe epithelium, epithelial breakdown, stroma, endothelium, contact lens fit, and lens condition. Under high magnification, in epithelium, you can observe vacuoles, microcysts, and dystrophies. Microcysts are nothing but they are just dots or map-like lines that are on cornea, and dystrophies are just like abnormal material buildup in the eye. When it comes to stroma, you can see the stray and poles. Then what is the stray? This is a linear line. Sometimes it might be fine or deep, and it may also result in the breakdown of decimate membrane. Next, coming to the endothelium, you can see polymegatism and cell density. Polymegatism is nothing but the size variability, cell size variability. Then, what are the filters used in biomicroscopy? This filter are used during the so first is code blue. Code blue filter with a blue filled circle. Actually, it is used with the conjugation with fluorescent stain. Whenever fluorescent stain is used, this cobalt blue filter is used. So, where there anything, any absence or like any broken breakage of the corneal endothelium, this fluorescent dye will appear as spots. Spots means like just crown-like structures. So this dye absorbs blue light and it just emits the green light. It can be used during the ocular staining or RGP lens fitting and the tear layer. Next, coming to green filter or red free filter. It is like green fill circle. Then why it is called as red free filter? It obscures anything that is red. So the red, it is known as red free light. Here the blood vessels or hemorrhages, it just appears as black. Then this filter just increases the contrast. It reveals the correct path and pattern of the inflamed blood vessels. Whereas coming to the neutral density, it is a circle with hashed lines. Here you can reduce the beam brightness and increase the comfort of patient. In case of the patient is photosensitivity, so you can use this neutral density filter. Next is yellow filter. It can be seen as yellow fill circle. It is a barrier filter placed in front of a weaving system. So it enhances the green staining, means it improves the quality. Next is diffuser. It is just a filter placed in front of the illumination source. So it is used for the general observation of the eye. Next is heat absorbing. It is mostly common in every slit lamp because if the patient can't take that much of heat, so this decreases the heat absorption and it gives the patient comfort. Next is slit lamp protein. So for doing slit lamp examination, we should keep in mind patient adjustment, instrument adjustment, then we should begin the slit lamp examination. First is patient adjustment. We should position the patient in such a way we should even adjust his chin rest height so that the outer canthus of the patient is at the level of the canthus alignment mark. Next is forehead opposed to the headrest. Next, use the focusing rod to adjust the focus of eyepiece and now start the observation. Next, you should even adjust the instrument. The height of the patient's the height of the slit lamp should be adjusted according to the patient's height. And the microscope and illumination system should be aligned to the patient's eye to be examined. Next, fixation target should be placed at the required position. Next, beginning of the slit lamp. Before we begin the slit lamp, we should keep some points in our mind that it should be carried in a semi-dark room. That is, the examiner's eye should be partially dark adopted so that if there is a sensitivity to low intensities of light to ensure that. Before performing a slit lamp examination on the patient, we should ensure that there is no medications like ointments or like anesthetic eye drops should be given to the patient. If that is given, it may produce the corneal surface disturbances. So there should be a minimum exposure of retina to light. Next, coming to illumination techniques. There are different illumination techniques: diffuse illumination, direct illumination, indirect illumination. So first we'll look into diffuse illumination. Here the diffuse illumination, you can see the light is spread evenly over the entire observed surface. Most often it is used in the slit lamp photography. And the angle between the microscope and the beam of light is 45 degrees. Here, most commonly in this diffuse illumination, we use a diffuser filter. In suppose, if we don't use a diffuser filter, we should decrease the intensity. So the magnification here used is least magnification, that is from 6x to 10x. In this case, sometimes we also may use cobalt blue and red free filters, which also act as diffuser, but white light is generally used. Here in this diffusion illumination, we can observe eyelids, lashes, conjunctiva, sclera, pattern of redness in the eye, iris, pupil, gross pathology, and some media opacities. Coming to the direct illumination. In this direct illumination, you can just see the observation and illumination system are focused at the same point, as you can see here. And the angular separation between these two will be 40 to 50 degrees. And in this direct illumination, the illumination have vary angle, and it may be magnification will be variable, width and height also will be variable depending upon the types. In this direct illumination, you have different types like optic section, parallel pipe, and conical beam. Let's look into the optic section. So what is optic section? Here, as you can see, optic section, it is just a very thin parallel pipe, and it optically cuts a very thin slice of cornea. And here you can see axis of illuminating and the weaving path. It just intersects in the area of anterior eye media to be example. Like it can be, we can even observe the individual layers of cornea through this optic section. And the angle between the illumination and the weaving path will be of 45 degrees. And the slit length should be kept small to minimize the brightness. Next, if at all the width narrow slit, if we use narrow slit, we can observe the depth and portion of different objects. Like we can even observe the penetration of foreign bodies or shape of lens, etc. The width narrow slit will be 1 millimeter or less. If we use a wider slit, then we should observe their extension and shape are more visibly clear. Like it will be clearly visible. Next, magnification is just maximum. In this optic section, we can even observe anterior chamber depth. It is performed by wider slit width, that is from 1 to 3 millimeter. This optic section is used to localize the nerve fibers, blood vessels, infiltrates, cataracts, and anterior chamber death. Next, coming to the parallel pipe. So this parallel pipe, here you can see the parallel pipe is a broader wave, and here it shows an illuminated block of cornea. And the angle between it will be like 40 degrees to 50 degrees. The slit width will be of 1 to 2 millimeters. And this provides a layered view of cornea and the lens. This parallel pipe provides the higher magnification than the wider beam illumination to evaluate both the depth and extent of corneal aberration. And it also provides it also shows the foreign bodies which causes the scars in the cornea. It also used for observation of corneal stoma, if there is any epithelial breakdown, any lens surface, and an endothelium. It also used in this parallel pipe, we can also use to detect corneal stray. Corneal stray is usually developed when there is any corneal edema, means swelling of the cornea. And this corneal edema usually occurs with hydrogel lens wear. Next, coming to the conical beam. Conical beam, it is, you can see here, it is produced by narrowing the vertical height of parallel pipe. And it also provides a small circular or square spot light. So the light, the angle between them, it will be like 45 to 50 degrees temporally. And it is directed directly into the pupil. And this conical beam, magnification is about 16x to 25x. This conical beam, it should be usually done in darkened room. Why it should be done in darkened room? Because it has a Tyndall phenomenon. Means Tyndall phenomenon is nothing but it is same that of beam of sunlight streaming through a room. You can even observe a very minute particle. So it is most useful when examining the transparency of anterior chamber for evidence of floating cells. And it can also see if any flare in the anterior uveitis. So this conical focusing, how can you focus this conical beam? The beam is just focused between the cornea and the anterior lens surface. Cornea and anterior lens surface. And you can see the dark zone between the cornea and the anterior lens surface. So in this Tyndall phenomenon, the cells, pigments, or protein in the aqueous humor, they just reflect like a faint fog. So if you want to see the cells and pigments, this slit illuminator should be adjusted to the small circular beam, and it should be projected through the anterior chamber. And it should be projected through the anterior chamber from a 42 degrees to 90 degrees angle. The slit illuminator should be projected through anterior chamber angle, and the angle should be to 42 to 90 degrees angle. And the strongest reflection in this conical beam can occur at 90 degrees angle. Next, coming to indirect illumination. This indirect illumination is completely opposite to the direct illumination. As you can see in indirect illumination, the observation system and illumination system are not focused at the same point. Whereas in direct illumination, the observation and illumination system are focused at one point. So here in indirect illumination, the angle between the light and illuminating will be of 30 to 45 degrees, and it just produces a decentered beam. Here the beam is focused in an area adjacent to the ocular tissue to be observed. So if you want to observe any area, the beam should be focused opposite to that of the area which you want to be observed. Like here you can examine the object in direct vicinity of corneal areas of reduced transparency. So if there is any corneal, any reduced transparency in cornea, you can just observe it. And this reduced transparency generally occurs due to the presence of any infiltrates or any corneal scars or any deposits in a cornea, and then epithelial and stromal defects in the cornea. The magnification will be approximately of 12x, and it just depends upon the size of the object. has coming to the retroillumination. Here in the retroillumination, you can see the object, you can see due to the object illuminated, you can see because of the reflected light. Means if you want to see the cornea is just illuminated by the light reflected from the iris, lens and fundus. Because of the light reflected from the iris, lens and fundus, the cornea will be illuminated. So it has angle, it varies angle, and here the moderate beam is used. So in this retroillumination, you can observe corneal neovascularization, edema, microcysts, vacuoles and infiltrate. In this retro, you have different types like direct retroillumination and indirect retroillumination. Here in indirect retroillumination, you can see here the prism and mirror is used so that the light reflected from lens or iris is directly aligned with the area under observation. You can clearly see that the observed feature is weaved in a direct pathway of reflected light. And you can see here, whereas in indirect illumination, the observer is at right angle to the observed structures. As you see in the direct illumination, the pathology is seen against the light background, whereas in the indirect, the pathology is seen against the dark background. In this both direct and indirect illumination, the width will be of 2 to 4 millimeters. And whereas in retroillumination, you have another type, that is marginal illumination. Here, the prism is also not used in this marginal illumination so that the light reflected from the lens or iris is just aligned at the pupil. So if you want to see the area under observation, it is aligned at the pupil due to the reflected light from the lens or iris. Next, coming to the specular reflection. It is produced by separating microscope and slit beam by equal angles from the normal to the cornea. As you see in the picture, the microscope and the slit beam is just separated equally and it is normal to the cornea, as you can see here. Here the angle of incidence will be equal to the angle of reflection. And the separation is of 60 degrees. Because of the 60 degrees, it produces the best specular reflection. If the area of high reflection is more, then the zone of specular reflection also will be high. In some cases, suddenly a small zone of reflection will appear at one time. So we should just instruct the patient to change the position of eye or just change the gaze of the eye so that the large area can be examined. Here in the specular reflection, the high magnification is used. Here in this specular reflection, you can even count the endothelial cells and you can even see the pathology in it. In specular reflection, you can also weave the endothelial cell layer, tear film debris and tear film lipid layer thickness. Next, coming to the sclerotic scatter. Here sclerotic scatter, you can weave a tall wide beam of 2 to 4 mm, and it is directed onto the limbal area. Here it is just directed onto the limbal area and this light will undergo total internal reflection. Total internal reflection is nothing but when angle of incidence is greater than a certain limiting angle. So here in the same way in the sclerotic scatter, this beam will undergo total internal reflection, which is directed onto the limbal area, and it just comes out from the limbus of the neck side. As you can see in this picture, it undergoes total internal reflection when it is directed onto the limbal area, and it just comes out of the neck side of the limbus. And the angle between these two will be of 45 to 60 degrees. And the illuminator should be slightly offset for this technique. As you see in the picture, it should be slightly offset. And the magnification used is 10x. And the microscope is just directed straight ahead. Okay. Then next, normal portion of the cornea in this sclerotic scatter just looks dark. If there is any opacities in it on the path of light, it shows a gray reflex. In the sclerotic scatter, you can just observe a central corneal edema, corneal aberrations, and corneal nebula. Means like it just a nebula means like a fog or mist. And you can see a macula. It is just a stain or spot. And you can even see the foreign bodies present in the cornea. Next coming, you can oscillating illumination of COP. In this illumination, the movement will be in an oscillatory movement, which is helpful to see a very minute objects or filament, especially in the transparent aqueous, which would otherwise escape detection. So another one, coming to the next topic, illumination techniques used in the contact lens. So first is diffuse illumination. By this illumination, you can just observe the contact lens fitting performance. Next, coming to the broad beam illumination. Here, the broad beam is used to observe the debris beneath the contact lens. And in the specular reflection, it is used to observe the lens front surfacing wet. And in retro illumination, you can even observe contact lens front and back surface deposits. Next, what are the uses of slit lamp microscope? In diagnosis, we just use for anterior and posterior segment diagnosis and in dry eye. Whereas in procedures, we use cold and applanation tonometer and tear breakup test, and in staining like fluorescein or rose Bengal, etc. And in gonioscopy, it is also used in visiometry and fundus fluorescein angiography and clinical photography. When it is therapeutic, it is used for foreign bodies removal and epilation, and it is also used in contact lens fitting and post-wear. It is used for corneal epithelial debris. And thank you.
Hello. It was a nice presentation. Can we move towards the discussion session now?
Yeah.
Just a minute. I think we don't have any queries today. Can we move towards So I'd like to request you to share your experience about for Optum.
Okay. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this platform, and I would like to express my profound gratitude to for Optum team for giving me and this wonderful opportunity of sharing my bit of knowledge. And I should also thank my beloved lecturers and mainly Rahul sir, who supported me and guided me.
Thank you so much, Pooja.
Thank you.
We'll end the session here. Thank you so much.